You're very good with children.
Thanks, I practiced on my hamster.
Oh. So you live alone?
I used to have a roommate, but my mom moved to Florida.
Oh. Why don't you come over here and sit with me?
Okay. So you want to play Boggle or Super Mario Brothers?
You know, I think motherhood's a very natural instinct. I like a child myself. Would you?
Tonight?
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another Sweet Sweet Podcast. I'm your host, Ciaran, and welcome to another sweet episode of Citizen Frame. We are spoiler-filled and contain harsh language, but all you regular listeners out there know that. I'm joined here with the regular band of misfits, Nuala.
Hi, hi.
Yo, yo. And Colin.
He slimed me.
No, not half. You were covered in
you.
It?
You.
Whoa. Sorry.
Did I miss something here?
Whoa. Like a plaster's whoa. Radio.
This is a family podcast?
Since when?
Since when, yeah.
I don't know. We're talking Ghostbusters 2.
In the last podcast, you're openly saying, blowjob, Ciaran?
I'm naughty. Oh, everybody, welcome back.
Welcome to Ghostbusters 2.
We're finishing off Ghostbusters with Ghostbusters 2 tonight. We're just going to dive into this one and talk about why I hate it so much. It takes place 5 years later.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's all I really care about. That's all I really got. Let's start off with the villain.
Vigo. Carpathian.
I did find a fun fact about this.
Yes.
Okay.
Vigo, as we know, is the actor who played one of the terrorists in Die Hard.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Well, you mean the actor who plays him, not Vigo himself.
No, Vigo.
No.
The actor himself.
The actor who plays Vigo.
Yes, he was James, I think.
Yeah, he couldn't he's from Romania. He didn't have, you know, very good English.
Yep.
So his voice is actually a guy we talked about quite a few times, Max von Sydow.
Ming the Merciless.
Yes.
And the priest from The Exorcist.
Yes. Uh-huh. And Conan.
And
Chief
so
Justice
good.
From Judge Dredd.
Yes. I mean, that guy's...
One of his better roles.
So I thought that was kind of cool.
Yeah.
And, so I did like that little tidbit. But that's all I've got. So, I'm sorry.
As in, that's all you've got about Vigo? Or that's all you really have to say about this movie?
No, I got more stuff.
I'm just feeling like my childhood taking a wee, like, dig to the kidneys every now and again whenever you're saying how shit this movie is. I'm like, oh, don't, Ciaran. No,
Here's the problem with the film. And, yes, it's Ghostbusters, so we're not going to overanalyze it about story, I suppose.
Mm.
But all they did here was copy and paste. They didn't do much different, and that I have a problem with. And if you're going to do a copy and paste, improve on it a little bit. Do something little, you know, give us something. They didn't do that. They took what worked in the first one, and they kind of peed on it on this one.
Yeah, I would tend to agree. That's everyone's biggest criticism of Ghostbusters 2 is it's basically a retread of Ghostbusters.
Yep.
Yeah,
you know, at the end of the movie, they were riding high, they'd saved the city. Should have been great for them. Like, they could have done something, but instead it was just, nope, slap back down to the beginning. Let's do it all from scratch.
Mm. See, I get what you guys are saying. You kind of feel that through the movie, but I think it kind of gets away with it too, because it's in the aftermath. It's a few years later after what happened in New York City after Gozer and all the destruction and them getting their lawsuits and things like that. So they're starting from scratch again there.
Okay.
You know, and they've actually, the kind of showed how the group was fractured too after all of that, you know. So you kind of see them coming back together as the Ghostbusters, you know, after the kind of falling apart and stuff. So it gives you that wee bit, and it's their climb back up to being accepted by everyone again, because who cared about them at that point, you know?
Well, that's the major flaw in the film. Mm. Yeah. I'll tell you why. Because you're spot on by saying they have to build back their reputation and stuff like that. And they're gone to doing their own little thing.
Yeah.
I agree with that concept. But the reason they got there is a joke. They got the mayor, who's no longer helping them out, who thinks they're assholes. But yet there are these heroes that pretty much saved the world. Mm-hmm. And now they're being sued, and they're doing this, and they're all being hated on. It makes no fucking sense.
Well, yeah, that part, like, why would they have done that to them after they saved the whole city, you know?
I can somewhat understand it when you consider it's the 80s America. It's Reagan's America and the aftermath of that, where there's a lot of cynicism. New York wasn't a great place back then, if I remember correctly, as well.
No, it was cleaned up. No, the 70s was where New York.
It was making progress, I think. Yeah, but it wasn't great. But you could see...
No, this is not...
I could fully see a city suing a company for damages to a building and surroundings, even if they saved it. Like, look how many people... Like, you got people who get, you know, say somebody gets saved from choking... That person then sues the person who saved them because they broke the rib.
Or, like, rational people can't believe that all happened, so it has to be down to some weird gas that's causing hallucinations, and these guys are con artists and pretty much put the whole city under the influence of something to see this, to rob them. Pretty much to get money off of the government or something like that. Who knows? Yeah. You know, no rational person's going to want to say, yeah, the whole town got attacked by a marshmallow monster and it took four guys with lasers to burn it to death. maybe it's that kind of thing.
I'd rather have seen something, maybe something happened to him during a routine ghost bust, and that's what busted him.
Like that the laser, like they shot a kid with a laser or something.
Something like that. Something happened to where they were put in the situation and give us that prequel scene, whatever happened. You know, that would have been all right. But we didn't get that. Yeah. Now, we do get the new comic relief. He's kind of replacing our boy Rick Moranis. Even though Rick Moranis is in this, we got Peter McNeil, who plays Dr. Poa.
Yes. Poa.
Yes, he's brilliant.
He's pretty funny. I'll give him that, but it's wasted, you know? I just think
it's also, correct me if I'm wrong, does he not play basically the exact same role in Dracula,
Bram Stoker's
Dead and Loving
Dracula, 100%.
Bram Stoker's Dracula?
Not Bram Stoker's, no, excuse me, the Dead and Loving It, thank you. But it's the piss take of Bram Stoker's Dracula.
That's
so
true.
Excuse me if it got mixed up, because, you know, they're practically the same, but one's absolutely hilarious.
Talk about night and day.
They're practically the same movie.
Well, yeah, Gary Oldman, Leslie Nielsen.
Yeah, of course, both excellent stars. Wonderful method actors, each of them, you know.
Actually, to be fair, I'm going to side on The Dead and Loving It being the better movie there.
I love Bram Stoker's Dracula, though, man.
I like
man.
Bram Stoker's, yeah. But a lot of people don't.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this, though. Okay, so they find that Dana, who happens to be, you know, known as the Ghostbusters, happens to be the one person who gets goo. What happens? She's walking the baby. And the wheels of a carriage get some of the goo on it, causing the carriage to go nuts and kind of start stopping in cars. It was supposed to be a really intense scene, but it wasn't.
No, it wasn't.
So how is she now targeted? How is Vigo targeted? Why is that baby targeted?
I think it was maybe coincidental. Just she happened to roll the pram over the goo, and Vigo was then like, oh, hey, baby, I could do with one of those.
Yeah, but like... Of all the babies in all the cities in all the world, she had, like, it had to pick up on that pram.
Well, yeah, see? But again...
You're backing me up now, Nuala.
No, I do get that. I do get that 100%.
It was a way to get her back into the movie. They had to have... Well, actually, for a sequel, it's one of the very few movies to get the entire cast back.
Yeah. Sure, yeah. Bill Murray didn't want to do a sequel. But him especially, he was really against doing a sequel for it.
Yeah, agreed.
Can't blame him.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. If I saw the script. But the funny thing is, we're going to nitpick this a bit, and it's unfortunate because we just talked about Ghostbusters, which we couldn't. because we just enjoyed it so much and went with it. This is just a remake done poorly.
It is. Now, what I will say is it had to be done, though, from the perspective of you had the first movie doing so financially well. I think it was the most successful comedy movie of all time up until that point. And then you had the creation of the real Ghostbusters, which then brought in all of the merchandise. You had all the toys, lunchboxes, and everything that we now have and we associate with Ghostbusters. And you have all this cash and new audience, and you have all these kids who wouldn't have probably seen the original because it was just outside their age range, wanting to see Ghostbusters 2. It had to be done. And as Bill Murray didn't want this to be done because he said that sequels are usually done for greed purposes, here we are.
Yeah, he's completely right. And I'm fine with sequels. Jesus Christ, I love horror films and slasher films.
Yeah, Halloween, look how many there are.
Jesus, I lost fucking count.
More of those than I've had hot dinners, good grief.
That's a lot, you've had a lot of hot dinners.
Yeah, I have.
But I just don't get how you come from such quality. And then even everything mirrored it, and it's poorly mirrored, like we guys just said. Because even the soundtrack, you went from Ray Parker's Ghostbusters to Bobby Brown singing I don't even know what the name of the song was.
Is it the one Your Love Lifting Me Higher?
Yeah, I don't mind that song.
Listen to YouTube knowing it.
Uh-huh, that's a great tune.
It's horrible.
It's not.
You think that's better than Ghostbusters?
No, it's not better, but it's...
No,
boom,
exactly. It's not the theme tune, though. That's what they use to get Lady Liberty up off her feet. And,
no, you know, it does feature Bobby
quite a
Brown.
Bit in that movie, and it is listed as...
Oh, it's not, is it?
No, that's I'm thinking it is. That. That's Aretha Franklin, isn't it?
No.
No.
No, it is. It's somebody like that.
No, it's not.
Who is it?
You do know there is a female vocalist in Lifting Me Higher?
There is. Jackie Wilson's the fella's name. Okay. Right, okay. That's the fella who sang Lifting Me Higher.
I thought it was a woman.
So did I, higher but then... But yeah, not Bobby but either Brown. Way, that's a good song.
Oh, that's okay. I don't mind that song. I'm talking about soundtrack in general. Besides,
it was fine. I thought it fitted with the movie at the time.
Wow, it was horrible.
Is it the Ghostbusters rap?
Yeah, it didn't take away from the actual Ghostbusters song itself because it did feature.
Yeah, it did, but it did. Not. I'd rather have that through the entire film than Bobby Brown.
I think it was okay.
All right.
What did take away from me was. I mean, again, maybe it could just be my aversion to children, but the very baby sequence, just, it was so focused on the child.
Yes. Let's not even talk about the rooftop scene.
Are we talking about how the baby managed to stand on a ledge?
Yep, and get kidnapped. Yeah.
Although, I'm not gonna, that scene, when I was a kid, freaked the hell out of me.
Yeah, no, I get that, because it reminded me of the Banshee and Darby O'Gill for some reason when I was a kid. Which was fucking terrifying. So, yeah. What a creepy, creepy baby snatcher.
But I think it's the fact that it was Peter McNichol as well.
Oh, yeah. He was playing like the... Like Mary Poppins, but...
Kinda. But a lot of... I think a lot of his scenes were actually some of the more creepy in Ghostbusters 2.
He came off... And this sounds horrible, and I'm not trying to offend anybody. But I'll say it anyway. Very kind of creepy, pedophile-y.
Mm. Well, he definitely came off as... He had the creep. He had his creep on, don't get me wrong. Definitely had his creep on. But it was toward Dana. He fucking...
Oh, I know that, yeah.
Proper creeped all over her. And from the start, you could see it when he's over, like, pretty much... playing with her hair and oh, it's just a bit of fluff. And you're like, oh, just don't.
But he does it so well.
He does.
He's a good actor, and he plays that role well. But his scenes, like even like whenever he visits her, when the power goes out,
yes,
and his eyes light up and he lights the,
bright eyes burning like fire.
I remember being freaked out by that.
It was pretty terrifying.
But that's my point. I mean, I think he plays it well, but it's pointless. It's just wasted. It's wasted talent on a poor script. That's what. And here's another thing. Okay, so
I'll give you that.
The The three Ghostbusters, excluding Venkman, because Data doesn't want them involving him because they've broken up. They're drilling a hole. This is the horrible scene.
I love this scene.
It's a horrible scene because this is what I don't get. It's so stupid. It's so bad. Why didn't you just use the manhole and go down to the sewer?
Well, That's true.
Yeah, that did confuse me.
But then you wouldn't
too.
Have the whole boss thing and then doing the whole Boston accent.
That's not funny.
Oh, I enjoyed it.
See, that's the pro. Oh, no.
Well, I am with both of you in this. I don't like the scene because it doesn't make sense, but I'm with Nuala in that I like, you know, the yo boss and
yeah, yo,
you know, Egon being
got
called
some
Ziggy.
Diaper down,
like,
in,
yo.
Down in City Hall, telling us to work on a Friday. You're like, yeah, I like it.
I just couldn't get over why they were doing it, so it ruined it for me. It took me out.
Mm.
That's the problem.
But there's a lot of that in this movie. Like, the part that I didn't get, right? I mean, maybe this is something I missed, or it might have been cutting room floor, or again, because it was a rushed movie, because I think Ghostbusters 2 is done even quicker than Ghostbusters. So they go from Ecto-1 being in a complete state.
Yeah.
Doing kids' birthday parties. And as an aside, the kid that's really rude to Ray is actually Jason Reitman, the director of Afterlife. It's the director's son. But they go from that, and, you know, Ray has his bookstore and everything like that. And, you know, by all means, they're probably not flush with cash. Don't even know if the fire station is still theirs. Then they fight the Scolari brothers, get the injunction lifted, and then the next thing you know, Ecto-1's all done up. They've got all new suits. They've got Janine rehired. They've got, you know, everything's
that's
all
good
going. Where did that money come from?
Yeah, that's...
It's something that I've noticed a couple of times, but watching it again today, as we said before, when you watch it a bit more of a critical eye, you're like,
Talk about all of a sudden Vigo wants the baby. Hey, wait a minute, is that Bill Murray's kid in this? Oscar, her kid's kid or not?
No.
No, it's some random twins that are used in
is the baby
for
his
that one
in
child.
The film?
No.
Okay.
No, Dana, in the 5 years from whenever they saved her in the first movie, they had gotten a relationship and broke up. And she found another guy, had a kid with him, and then they broke up.
Okay.
So it was a very eventful 5 years for Dana.
Yeah, she really moves pretty quick, doesn't she?
She gets around. She gets around. I'm sorry.
All right. So, again, we talk about copy and paste. This is all they do here. But there is one scene I did like, and they're copying pretty much the hotel scene. But this, instead of a hotel, it's the courtroom.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of like the courtroom stuff, especially the lawyer.
that guy needs to calm down. Give himself a heart attack. That's one angry ass dude.
But no, I'm talking about the whole lawyer scene.
Oh, the lawyer, yeah.
And he's
I'm thinking the judge.
And Rickman's talking to him as he's telling him what to
say. Being a lawyer.
Yes. Oh.
And the judge, I always like to see Harris Yulin. And I do like the little twist where the ghosts come out because obviously you find out that the slime, if it's happy joy, it's calm and relaxed. If it's raising your voice, it gets abrupt. So as the judge is raising his voice, the two people he sent to a death row come out. I thought that was clever.
Yeah, that's the dude that needs to calm down, by the way. That was really good. And the Scolari brothers, that they came out on the electric chairs and stuff.
Yeah.
I remember being a kid and being like, oh, holy shit. When they came out, they looked like boss devil ghosts, really.
Now, the funny thing about those two is they were designed to be more cartoonish and not be as quite as a human form that they were being murdered in the chair.
Yeah, they're too creepy.
I think that
fuckers.
Made them look creepier and scarier.
This is why I like that scene, because you're spot on, Colin, because it crossed that line of little too far, you know, where it's not as kiddie-like, you know, kind of pushed.
Which is what this movie was actually made for. This was the real Ghostbusters sequel that was to get in those kids. So that's why they went kiddie, but that one kid part actually played the reverse. It actually helped it.
Yeah. a mistake, I guess, in our favor. But it plays well. It's a good scene. If you want to watch anything in Ghostbusters 2, watch that scene. I wish I had the minutes and time it's on. That way you can get to it right away and then delete the rest.
It's about 30 minutes in.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
I'm sure you could.
Yeah.
You could just YouTube about a court scene and away scene. You go.
The bathtub scene.
Yeah, it looks
Thank you.
Oh, I hate this. No, it's not that. Mm-hmm. How absent do you have to be not to notice that the water has stopped running and that there's now just a weird glug of slime behind you? And this
kind
of
goes back to what you said in the last Ghostbusters, how it was kind of easy to get. That was no threat. Arr! And she runs away. There was didn't need it.
Mm.
Pointless. Yeah. I mean, it was pointless.
As in, like, she could have just stepped out of the room.
It would have oozed out onto the floor. I mean, the bathtub didn't like the way the bathtub looked whenever they bent it. It didn't look great.
Exactly.
That's what I meant about it not looking great. But no, I get what you mean. How absent do you have to be to not hear that, like?
Yes.
Yeah, I feel like it's a small drip or anything like that. It was a full bathtub running. You'd have heard that stop and become slime.
What about... Who's the guy who's replacing... William Atherton.
Herdmeyer, I think his name is.
He's the one who sends them because they decide the Ghostbusters are going, there's something going on here. We got to go talk to the mayor now again. The mayor who kind of screwed them the first time. Then the mayor just says, get rid of them. And he ends up putting them in a psych ward. Again.
He does, he has them committed, which, funny enough, the person
Ryan
committing
Doyle
them
Murray.
Is Bill Murray's brother.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
There you go.
He has his brothers in all of his films.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you didn't know it was his brother? He's also in Groundhog Day. He's the guy with the groundhog.
No, I think that's because...
He's not in Ghostbusters, though, is he?
He was last minute, Bill Murray, for that, so they probably didn't have time to get all of them. You remember Scrooge?
Okay.
His brother was his actual brother.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah. Oh, yeah, we discussed that before about his brothers being in all of his movies.
Yeah.
I just didn't know that was him.
No, his brother was,
brother plays his brother, too.
Yep. There's two of his brothers in it, I think, at least two. Mm-hmm.
There's Brian Doyle Murray, obviously Bill Murray, and then the younger one who didn't really have much of a career.
Child Murray.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
And so with all the chaos starts happening with the goo, and obviously it's a good setting for the goo to get abrupt and get angry because obviously you're in New York and everyone yells at each other in New York. Mm-hmm. It's a place of chaos. And like they did in the last one, they had all the ghosts start coming up, all these things start wreaking havoc in the city.
The mink coat.
That's
by
the one I liked.
Brilliant. Mm-hmm. It's really well done.
I actually have that in my notes. The fur coat scene was pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
It was, yeah. Now that one, like you have that going on. You have the ghost coming out of the cinema. You have Slimer eating the hot dogs. You've got more of a ghost presence, but again, like I mentioned in the last podcast, after that, everything just kind of dies down, and instead, again, everyone congregates outside.
I think
the
what's
art
going
museum
on here,
waiting on the Ghostbusters.
They did the same thing in the last one, like you just mentioned. And I think the only reason they do that, they have all these ghosts and havoc, you needed it so the mayor can go get the Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
So you have to have it, but if you have to have
that
it,
is true.
Give us a 5-minute expose of what happens to them or what, you know what I mean? Give us something. But again, it all boils down to budget. And as you said, this movie, and it really shows, they rushed it. So.
I dislike the ending in this one.
What?
Even more than Ghostbusters 1.
I hate this one.
What, you prefer this one?
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, Ciaran, I thought you said you liked.
I dislike this one.
I thought
one
you
more.
Said you liked. Oh, it's so bad. It reminds me of the end of... Well, I like
No, I dislike
groups,
this one more.
When they sing, give a little piece of mine, which is a nice ending. You choke
up. Yeah, it's
up.
Good.
It works. Don't get me wrong. I'm not disrespecting Scrooge. But it doesn't work for this. This is a horrible ending. Again...
No.
You got this powerful giant.
Go ahead.
I will say in the beginning when he's like the print would look at you and look in the eyes and pop up. I thought it was kind of cool. So you're going something with this. What a waste of a villain. Did not have to do anything to destroy this guy.
No. And they could have gone places, and they did actually mean to go places. So you have that scene where
there was supposed to be a whole thing with that, where he's possessed and like drives the car really sporadically and actually like tries to fight them at one point, and then they have to break him out of that possession. Yeah, that's right. I remember reading about that. I was like, that would have been brilliant. Yeah.
And instead, exactly, we just get, you're getting slammed back into the painting and then it explodes and turns into a nice painting.
I know,
of the
that was always a bit questionable. Like, no.
Wait a minute, was that scene still
even there? As a kid, I didn't like that.
When they're the painting of the baby in the Ghostbusters?
Which part?
Yeah, that's still in it.
That's probably where I just got up and got a cup of coffee or something. Mm-hmm.
Well, at that point, that is the end of the movie. But yeah, once Vigo gets pushed back into the painting, there's like an explosion, the shell lifts on the outside of the museum, and then I think it's Winston is like, hey, look. And it's the four of them standing kind of like...
God. Yeah, I remember that now.
Classically posed with the toga, with the baby in the middle.
Right there.
Yeah.
I will say this to our people out there who are a fan of this. Tully was nice to see again. I do like him, the babysitting scene, and how he's getting it on, which, you know, the receptionist.
It was so cute because he didn't pick up on the signs at all. Like, Janine's being really friggin' obvious. And he's like, do you want to play a game or, you know?
Yeah, Boggle or Super Mario.
Yeah, it's so cute. He's such a wee nerd. It's lovely.
And then when he puts on the Ghostbuster outfit and he goes and he starts firing the packet. Everyone thinks he's the one who saved the day.
That is so cute. That is so cute.
And then you've got Slimer giving him the lift on the bus.
Yeah.
And the fact that he got on the bus, I didn't know you had your license.
So stupid.
Yeah. There's a lot in this movie that I enjoyed. Like one scene that I enjoyed was when they were underground in the train station or like the train tunnels. And they're walking along with the echo, if you remember.
Yeah, just because... another scene which was really creepy for a PG.
Yeah, big time creepy in that.
All the heads.
Yeah, fucking right. And the fact that whenever they're all echoing or shouting and it echoes back and Winston yells and it growls his name.
Winston.
Uh-huh. Really good. That's one of my favorite scenes. And then the ghost train and Winston's just standing there frozen. Did you get the number on the train? No.
I must have missed it.
Yeah, I mean, it's got flashers, but that's how I look at it as. I mean, coming off, you get 5 years to give us a sequel to one of the greatest films that, you know, comedy's ever produced. And this is what you give us. Tidbits. You give us tidbits.
But a lot of the time, sequels just don't further anything unless you change it. You know, Aliens from Alien, they changed it. Terminator 2 from Terminator changed it.
Well, they did.
Like Back to the Future 2 still furthers the story.
Yeah.
Ghostbusters 2 didn't do anything.
That's my point. They just rehashed it badly. The first one. They remade the first one badly is what they've done. They didn't do anything. Alien went from horror sci-fi to sci-fi action. Then they changed it. There you go.
Same with Terminator to Terminator 2. That went from a horror to an action.
To sci-fi horror. To sci-fi action. Exactly. Spot on. These guys did nothing. And I completely agree with Bill Murray. Completely agree. But we do got Ghostbusters Afterlife coming. So I'm hoping we've got a gem here. Because I'll quickly will mention the Ghostbusters reboot that came out with the girls. No disrespect to an all-woman cast. I like the cast that was in it. I do like Melissa McCarthy. But my God, what a piece of shit film. I put out something on Facebook when I saw it, and you won't believe the thing I put on there. It was just unreal how bad this film was. And what shocked me most, all the Ghostbusters made cameos. That just threw me off. So I'm so happy that they're doing this film, and I hope they do it justice.
Yeah.
Well, it was... I don't think Harold did. He had passed at that time, didn't he?
Yes.
He was like 2014 or something, so yeah. But did Bill Murray? Okay, so I'm guessing he really did want that paycheck by that point.
I'm shocked. That's why I was shocked. He was shocked.
Yeah. Now, Dan Aykroyd, I can understand, because he is the one who has continued Ghostbusters.
Yeah, it's his baby.
Now, the one thing I will say is Nuala has some experience with this game, I think, but... Ghostbusters for, I believe it was the Xbox 360.
Yeah, I played it.
Which was technically Ghostbusters 3.
Oh, yes, that's right, uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It wasn't too bad. It actually brought back William Atherton.
Oh, yeah. I remember playing it years ago, and I thought it was pretty cool. Did they remaster it?
I don't believe so, no. But, like, they had everyone. Like, they had Annie Potts in. You had her in as Janine. The only person I don't think that they had was Rick Moranis, which, you know, for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
I think even... I think Harold was in it at that point, too.
Yeah, he would have been around then. He would have been around then. Well, there you go. Nuala has a soft spot for it.
I have a soft spot for it because, like, yes, it has its problems, but you can enjoy it, you know what I mean? Like, it's the Ghostbusters for me. And I guess I kind of given it a wee bit of a pass. It isn't as good as the first one, certainly not. But, okay, I don't know. I just I've always enjoyed it.
To each their own. I mean, Christ, I love Commando.
Well, yeah.
So we all have our guilty pleasures. Colin, real quickly, what you think?
I am split on it. I don't hate the movie. Mm-hmm. Like, I know you're just like, it sucks. But I do fall into sort of Nuala's category of, it's still Ghostbusters at the end of the day. So you can watch it, you can enjoy it. But just know it is very much a rehash of the first one.
Yeah.
Okay. Fair enough. My review is quite simple. Shit.
Straight to the point. Terrible movie. And you were having a go at me for my one-liners. Or one-worders, even.
All right, guys. Thanks for joining me in this one. Nuala, thank you as usual.
Oh, glad to be here. I got to watch Ghostbusters movies back-to-back, so that was fun.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Colin, thanks for having us. Thanks for jumping on.
I know you don't mean it, but no problem.
I don't mean it. You're right.
Just you wait till I get on for Halloween.
I can't wait. Oh, okay, guys. Anybody who knows this podcast, I please have your phones on ready to call 999. Oh, wait. We're not live, though. Damn it.
Well, we'll already be dead if we have a problem with it. Ciaran will be right. We'll be buried in the back garden under the tomato patch.
I know. Yeah,
if after somehow you've listened to Halloween... I or Nuala don't return for the sequels, you'll know something's gone wrong.
Yeah.
What? Yep. Maybe Michael paid you a visit.
Yeah.
Yes, this will we finish off our Ghostbuster retrospective in mid or late November when the sequel comes out. It's gonna, I hope it's good. I really do.
Yeah.
But again, like you guys mentioned, I believe that was you, Colin. It's still in the family. Dan Aykroyd, Ivan Reitman are all involved heavily. And Jason Reitman, who's a very competent director, is helming it. So I'm looking forward to it. All right, guys, looking forward to the Halloween retrospective. What am I going to say? I have no idea. Oh, yes, you can reach out to us, which you never do, but please do if you decide you want to. We're CitizenFrame_podcast at Instagram and Facebook. Again, thank you for all the downloads. We had a massive peak yesterday, like 45 nice. Downloads, which we do appreciate. So that means we have some new listeners coming on board. Thank you, and we'll all chat soon. We'll talk to you next time with Halloween.
Bye.